Quantum field theory is currently the go-to theory to describe the world around us. But what exactly is a quantum field? The concept of a field alone does not yet involve quantum behavior. In fact, classical field theory is a huge field by itself. Newtonian gravitation can be described using a gravitational field and its connection to the gravitational force. Electromagnetism is described by a scalar and a vector potential, which together form the electric and magnetic fields. So describing a particle with a field and using a Lagrangian density instead of a Lagrangian function is not inherently quantum. For a real scalar field, the Lagrangian is given by a kinetic term involving derivatives and a potential term. The potential term includes a mass term and possibly interaction terms, but we focus on a non-interacting field for this video, which is also called a free field. Applying the Euler-Lagrange equations gives us the Klein-Gordon equation. In order to solve this equation, we use a simple exponential ansatz, e to the ikx, which is actually I omega t minus ikx. Plugging this into the Klein-Gordon equation gives ik mu ik mu plus m squared e to the ikx equals 0. For this equation to be valid for all x, the bracket must vanish. This condition gives us a relation between omega and k. It follows that the zero component and the spatial components of k mu are not independent. Usually, we solve this equation for omega, so from now on, omega is actually a function of k. Note that there are two solutions to this equation, plus the square root of k squared plus m squared and minus the same square root. This will be important later. Now that we know an exponential ansatz solves the Klein-Gordon equation for one specific k mu, the most general solution is a combination of all possible k mu. Therefore, we take the integral over d3k. Why d3k and not d4k? Well, k0 is not an independent variable. This looks like some kind of Fourier transformation, so we can interpret a and b as the Fourier coefficients of the field. There are three conditions we impose on the field. First, it is a real field. Phi is equal to phi dagger. Second, it is on shell, which means that the relativistic energy-momentum relation is fulfilled. Mathematically, k squared should be equal to m squared. This rules out describing virtual particles that may appear in scattering processes. Third, we want positive energy solutions. Remember that we got two solutions for omega earlier in the video. Well, from now on, we only want the positive solution. Condition 1 implies that the Fourier coefficients, which we call b, are actually the complex conjugated versions of a. So let's write them as a star. Conditions 2 and 3 together imply that we should add some terms to the integration measure d3k. This gets usually abbreviated by dk tilde and is now Lorentz invariant. At the end of this video, we will prove these statements. Now that we implemented special relativity by means of condition 2 and 3, we are ready to make our field quantum. There are basically two approaches, canonical quantization and path integrals. Canonical quantization means that two conjugated degrees of freedom fulfill a commutation relation. In non-relativistic quantum mechanics, this was the commutator xp, which is equal to ih bar. And for our quantum field theory, we would need a commutator between phi and some momentum field, and set it equal to ih bar. During this process, we say that phi gets promoted to an operator. The second approach, path integrals, skips the definitions of operators and directly enables us to compute scattering amplitudes. Since path integrals deserve a video on their own, we will continue with canonical quantization. The step from the classical theory to the quantum theory is the usage of this commutator. So first we need to find out what this momentum field pi really is. If you remember classical mechanics, the conjugated momentum to the generalized coordinate q was given by the derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to the time derivative of q. So let's do exactly the same for our fields. We define pi to be the derivative of the Lagrangian density with respect to the zero derivative of phi. A quick look at the Lagrangian reveals that pi is the zero derivative of phi. Now it's easy to also write down an expression for pi. Since phi and pi are now operators, a and a star are operators as well. To remember this, let's write a star as a dagger from now on. Let's summarize what we've seen so far. We started with a Lagrangian of a real scalar field and solved the corresponding equations of motion. This gave us an expression for phi in terms of Fourier coefficients a and a star. After accounting for special relativity, we implemented quantum mechanics by choosing the way of canonical quantization. Canonical quantization means that we see phi now as an operator that fulfills a certain commutation relation. The commutator between phi and pi is a generalization of the commutator found in non-relativistic quantum mechanics. Also, the Fourier coefficients A and A dagger are now operators. They fulfill certain other commutation relations. We finally have our answer. The thing that makes a quantum field quantum is the fact that it has to obey a certain commutation relation. Whether you express this commutator in terms of phi and pi, or in terms of A and A dagger, is a matter of taste. So now let's talk about the promised calculations. First, we claimed that B equals A star, as a consequence of phi being real. This can be seen by writing down phi and its conjugate. If we look at phi dagger and want that it is equal to phi, the coefficients in front of the exponential functions must be the same. This means B equals A star and B star equals A. Second, the Lorentz invariant integration measure. The motivation goes like this. We saw that K0 is not independent from K, so it makes no sense to integrate over K0. This leaves the integral over d3k, which is not Lorentz invariant because it treats some parts of a 4-vector different than the others. So we want to find a Lorentz invariant way of integrating over d3k. Here we can use the following trick. Let's start with d4k again and add a delta function of k squared minus m squared. This ensures the relativistic energy momentum relation. Next, we add a Heaviside function of k0, thus only considering positive energies. All of this is fully Lorentz invariant. Now we separate the d4k into dk0 from minus infinity to plus infinity and the d3k. The Heaviside function changes the integration region of dk0. And the delta function can be evaluated like this. We use a nice formula to simplify a function inside a delta function. Xi are those values where the function is 0, and in the denominator there's the derivative of the function. This means we have to find the zeros of k squared minus m squared. It's not surprising that this gives us the expression for omega again. We can split up the delta function into two delta functions and immediately see that one of them cannot be fulfilled, since both k0 and omega are greater than 0. It is conventional to throw a 2 pi to the power 3 in there and call everything dk tilde. And after the dk0 integration, every k0 will now be replaced by omega. That's pretty much it for this time. Thanks for watching.